Welcome squad to another video. This is 9700 May-June 2021 paper 1-3. If you are new to this channel, you know what to do. Like, comment, subscribe, and now let's watch and learn. Question 1. Which set of measurements is correct? The columns given are diameter of capillary, diameter of red blood cell, thickness of cell surface membrane of red blood cell. A key point you must keep in mind is that the thickness of a cell membrane is 7 nanometers. Therefore, the answer is either A or B. And the diameter of both the capillary and the red blood cell is 7 micrometers. 7 nanometers is only for the thickness of cell surface membrane. Hence, the answer is A. Diameter of capillary, 7 micrometers. Diameter of red blood cell, 7 micrometers. Thickness of cell surface membrane of the red blood cell, 7 nanometers. Question 2. The diagram shows an eyepiece graticule and part of a stage micrometer scale as seen using times 100 magnification. Which is the correct method for calculating the value of one eyepiece graticule unit in micrometers? The unit needed is in micrometers, however given is in millimeters. So we have to convert it to micrometers by multiplying by 1000 because 1 millimeter is equal to 1000 micrometers. And the eyepiece graticule measured is from 0 to 100 divisions. And if we place the eyepiece graticule alongside the stage micrometer scale, you can see that 100 divisions is equal to 0.1 millimeter times 1000, because remember again, we have to convert it into micrometers. So 100 divisions is equal to 0.1 times 1000. 1 division is equal to, or 1 eyepiece graticule unit is equal to 0.1 times 1000, and the entire thing divided by 100, because there are 100 eyepiece graticule units. And the only answer that talks about this is answer C. Multiply 0.1 by 1000, then divide by 100. Question 3. A prokaryotic cell 1 micrometer in diameter is magnified 50,000 times on an electron micrograph. What is the diameter as shown in the electron micrograph? Key formula over here is that magnification is equal to image size upon actual size. And they have given the magnification, which is 50,000. Actual size is 1 micrometer. And they're asking the diameter as shown in the electron micrograph. That means they're asking for the image size. Therefore, if we rearrange the formula, magnification is equal to image size upon actual size, you get the formula as image size is equal to magnification times actual size. And therefore, 50,000 into 1 will give you the image size, which is 50,000 micrometers. However, the answers are in millimeters. Therefore, what do? In order to convert from micrometers to millimeters, we have to divide by 1000, because 1 millimeter is equal to 1000 micrometers. Since we need to find it in millimeters, we have to divide it by 1000. And thus, you get the answer as 50 millimeters. The answer is C, 50 millimeters. Question 4. Which cell structures contain DNA? 1 mitochondria, 2 chloroplasts, 3 centrioles, 4 nucleolus. Actually, all structures contain DNA except centrioles. Remember that centrioles and centrosomes do not contain any DNA. Mitochondria and chloroplasts contain circular DNA, and nucleolus obviously has DNA. Hence, the answer over here is answer B, 1, 2, and 4. Question 5. 4 students were asked to match the function with the appearance of some cell structures in an animal cell. The functions were listed by number. 1. mRNA passes through to the ribosome. 2. Synthesis of polypeptides. 3. Synthesis of lipids. The appearances were listed by letter. V. Membranes which surround an enclosed inner cavity. W. Non-membrane bound spherical structures. X. A double membrane interspersed with pores. Y. Non-membrane bound cylindrical structures. And Z. Membrane bound sacs arranged as a flattened stack. Which student correctly matched a numbered function with the appearance of the cell structure? mRNA passes through to the ribosome. This right here is the process of transcription, where after the mRNA is synthesized, it has to pass through to the ribosome, and it passes through what? It passes through the nuclear envelope. And the appearance that describes the nuclear envelope is a double membrane interspersed with pores. Therefore, one should match with X. Therefore, the only answers that are possible are C and D. Let's look at function 2, synthesis of polypeptides. This definitely occurs in the ribosomes, because ribosomes are responsible for protein synthesis, or in other words, polypeptides. And the appearance which describes this is non-membrane bound spherical structures, because ribosomes do not have any membrane, and yes, they are spherical. Hence, 2 matches with W. And that leaves us with the only answer being C. Let's look at function 3, synthesis of lipids. That takes place in the ER, known as the endoplasmic reticulum, and the appearance that describes this is membranes which surround an enclosed inner cavity. This appearance is linked with the endoplasmic reticulum. Do keep in mind the functions and the correct appearances. Again, 1 matches with X, 2 matches with W, and 3 matches with V. Hence, the answer is C. Question 6. Which row is correct for structures found in eukaryotic cells? The columns given are circular DNA, 70S ribosomes, as well as 80S ribosomes. They're asking about eukaryotic cells, and 80S ribosomes are definitely present in all eukaryotic cells, therefore leaving us with the answer being either A or C. And then circular DNA as well as 70S ribosomes. These, although found in prokaryotic cells, these are also found in eukaryotic cells. How, you ask? Well, it is present in mitochondria, which all eukaryotic cells do have, as well as it is also present in chloroplasts. And since plant cells are also considered to be eukaryotic, yes, circular DNA and 70S ribosomes are present in eukaryotic cells, hence the answer being A. Circular DNA, 70S ribosomes, and 80S ribosomes are all present in eukaryotic cells. Question 7. 4 solutions were tested for the presence of 4 different biological molecules. The appearance of the solutions after each test are shown in the table. Which solutions contain molecules with ester bonds? Ester bonds are present in fats or lipids, which is formed by fatty acids and glycerol. Hence, should be checked in the solution that gives a positive test result under the emulsion test, because only the emulsion test is responsible for fats. Benedict's test is for the presence of reducing sugars, Bayer test is for the presence of proteins, and emulsion test is for the presence of fats. And ester bonds are present in fats. It is not present in sugars, because in sugars it is glycosidic bonds that are present. And in proteins, it is peptide bonds that are present, not ester bonds. Ester bonds are present only in fats or lipids. Thus, we should look for the solution that contains a positive test result under the emulsion test. And what is a positive test result for the emulsion test? Well, it is the cloudy suspension. Hence, the only answers that have cloudy suspension in it are 1 and 3. Therefore, the solutions that contain molecules with ester bonds are 1 and 3 only. That is, the answer is B. Question 8. The diagrams represent 2 monosaccharides with the same molecular formula, C6H12O6. Both can exist in an alpha or beta form as shown. The diagram shows a lactose molecule formed by condensation between glucose and galactose. Which molecules have condensed to form lactose? The diagram which shows a lactose molecule formed by condensation between glucose and galactose shows the presence of a beta glycosidic bond, because that is how a beta glycosidic bond looks like. It is like a form of a Z-shaped bond in the middle. Why is that? It is because when beta molecules are linked together, one is rotated 180 degrees relative to the other in order to link with the other molecule. Therefore, when 2 beta molecules join together, this is how a beta glycosidic bond looks like. Hence, the 2 molecules that have condensed to form lactose should have the beta form in it. Let's look at the answers. A. Alpha glucose and alpha galactose. That is incorrect, because it should have both being beta form. B. Alpha glucose and beta galactose. Again incorrect. C. Beta glucose and alpha galactose. That is also incorrect. And D, beta glucose and beta galactose. That is the correct choice because both have a beta form in it, and thus that is how a beta glycosidic bond looks like when they join together, and that is how the lactose molecule is formed. Hence the answer is D. Question 9. One type of covalent bond between two monomers is shown. Which molecules contain this type of covalent bond? Shown over here is of a glycosidic bond, not peptide bond. And how do I know this? Well, you have to refer to your textbook for this one. You have to refer to how each bonds are formed. If you see an oxygen atom in the middle, that should definitely strike that this is a glycosidic bond, not a peptide bond. Because peptide bond is formed between COOH and NH2 group. So which molecules contain this type of covalent bond? Definitely not proteins. And since amylase is an enzyme and all enzymes are proteins, the answer has to be C, because answer A, B and D has amylase in it, and amylase is an enzyme and hence is a protein, whereas proteins do not have this type of bond. Therefore the only answer possible over here is C, amylopectin, glycogen and starch. And yes, you can see that there is a formation of 1,6 linkages, which means the molecule is branched. And yes, glycogen and starch as well as amylopectin are branched molecules and therefore would definitely have 1,6 linkages. Question 10. Which statements about carbohydrates and triglycerides are correct? 1. They form polymers. 2. They contain carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. 3. They are used as energy stores. Carbohydrates and triglycerides are already polymers and not monomers. Hence, 1 is incorrect. They do not form polymers because they are already polymers. Polymers are formed from monomers. Whereas carbohydrates and triglycerides, they are macromolecules. They are not monomers. And they are itself polymers. Thus, answers having 1 in it are incorrect, leaving us with the only possible answer being D, 2 and 3 only. They contain carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. Yes, that is correct, because carbon, hydrogen and oxygen are present in carbohydrates and triglycerides, whereas in proteins there is an extra element which is nitrogen. However, over here it's only concerned with carbohydrates and triglycerides. Therefore yes, it would have carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. 3. They are used as energy stores. That is definitely correct. Carbohydrates and triglycerides, they can be stored. Triglycerides can be stored in the form of fats. Carbohydrates can be converted to glycogen, which can then be stored. And thus, they are used as energy stores too. Therefore, the answer is D, 2 and 3 only. Question 11. Which molecules contain at least 3 double bonds? If you go to the answers, answers A, B and D have saturated fatty acid in it. However, saturated fatty acids only have single bonds. They do not have double bonds at all. Therefore, these molecules, they cannot contain 3 double bonds when they do not have one itself. Therefore, answers A, B and D are incorrect, leaving us with the only possible answer being C, hemoglobin and collagen. And over here in this question, you just have to rule out the incorrect answers, and that leaves us with the correct answer. Because saturated fatty acids can no way have double bonds. It's only unsaturated fatty acids that have double bonds. Saturated fatty acids only have single bonds. Hence again, the answer is C, hemoglobin and collagen. Question 12. The diagram shows the structures of two amino acids. One contains two amino groups labeled 1 and 2. The other contains two carboxylic groups, COOH groups, labeled 3 and 4. A peptide bond is formed between the two amino acids. Which groups form the peptide bond? Peptide bonds are only formed between COOH and a NH2 group that is bound to CH only. Whereas if you look at the groups labeled 1 and 4, 1 is bound to a C double bond O group. Therefore, it is not part of the formation of a peptide bond. Peptide bond can only be formed between COOH and NH2 group if it is only bound to a CH group in the middle. And you can see that groups 2 and 3 are definitely bound to a CH group in the middle. The group labeled as 2, that is NH2, is bound to CH, and the group labeled 3 is also bound to CH. And as I mentioned earlier, a peptide bond can only be formed between a COOH group and an NH2 group if it is only bound to a CH group in the middle. Thus, the groups that form the peptide bond are 2 and 3. Hence, the answer is B, 2 and 3 only. Answers having 1 and 4 in it are incorrect because they both are bonded to an incorrect group. They are not bonded to a CH group in the middle. Thus, the answer is B. Question 13. Which row about the structure of proteins is correct? The columns given are primary structure, secondary structure, tertiary structure, and quaternary structure. And if you look at answer A, primary structure is a number of amino acids present in a protein. That is incorrect because primary structure, the meaning behind it is a sequence of amino acids. It is not the number of amino acids present. Thus, answer A, the meaning behind each of these structures doesn't really represent the structure itself. Therefore, answer A is incorrect. Answer B. Primary structure is the order of amino acids present in a protein encoded by DNA. Secondary structure is a coiling of a chain of amino acids to form a beta-pleated sheet or an alpha helix. Tertiary structure is a shape formed by the folding of a polypeptide and is held together by hydrogen bonds. That is again incorrect because tertiary structure not only involves hydrogen bonds, it can also involve ionic bonds, disulfide bridges, as well as hydrophobic interactions. There are four possible bonding involved in tertiary structure. Again, ionic bonding, hydrogen bonding, disulfide bridges, as well as hydrophobic interactions. Therefore, answer B is incorrect. Answer C. Primary structure is a result of translation of an mRNA molecule by a ribosome into a chain of amino acids. Secondary structure occurs because of an attraction between hydrogen and oxygen atoms in the peptide bonds. Tertiary structure is a result of ionic and hydrogen bonds, disulfide bridges, and hydrophobic interactions between amino acids. Quaternary structure is formed by four polypeptides and an additional reactive group attached to a protein. That is incorrect. Quaternary structure doesn't necessarily have to have four polypeptides. If it has more than one polypeptide, then it can have a quaternary structure. Thus, answer C is incorrect. Answer D. Primary structure is a sequence of amino acids in a protein coded by an mRNA molecule. Yes, that is correct. Secondary structure is formed by hydrogen bonding between amino acids forming the primary structure. Yes, that is also correct because secondary structure only involves hydrogen bonding. Primary structure involves peptide bonds being formed. Secondary structure involves hydrogen bonding being formed. Tertiary structure involves four types of bonding being involved. And it is mentioned by the answer C itself. And quaternary structure can also have these same four types of bonds as present in a tertiary structure. And the meaning under tertiary structure given for answer D is, tertiary structure is formed as a result of interaction of the side chains of amino acids in the primary structure. Yes, that is also correct. And quaternary structure is formed by the linking together of more than one polypeptide to form a protein. Yes, because as I mentioned earlier, quaternary structure, if it has more than one polypeptide, then it can form a quaternary structure. Therefore, the correct answer over here is D. And you can see over here that I have mentioned, primary structure is a sequence of amino acids in a polypeptide, only involves peptide bonds. Secondary structure is a folding and coiling of these amino acids and only involves hydrogen bonding. Quaternary structure is a linking together of more than one polypeptide chain. Question 14. The enzyme beta-galactosidase can catalyze the hydrolysis of four substrates with similar structures. Each substrate gives a different Km value. For which substrate does beta-galactosidase have the highest affinity? Key points you must remember are that higher the Km value, lower the enzyme affinity. Lower the Km value, higher the enzyme affinity. They have an opposite correlation between the two. Higher the Km, lower the enzyme affinity. Lower the Km, higher the enzyme affinity. Therefore, since the question refers to for which substrate does the enzyme have the highest affinity, we should look for the substrate having the lowest Km value, because lower the Km value, higher the enzyme affinity. And the answer with the lowest Km value is answer D, 1 into 10 to the power minus 4. All the other Km values are greater than 1 into 10 to the power minus 4. Thus, D has the highest affinity because it has the lowest Km value. Question 15. An investigation was carried out on the effect of temperature on the activity of an enzyme when it is immobilized and when it is non-immobilized, free in solution. The product of the enzyme-catalyzed reaction causes a decrease in pH. The graph shows the results of the investigation, which would give the highest yield of product. In this question, the last statement leads to the idea that the reaction is breaking down fats or lipids. Why is that? Because it mentions the product of the enzyme-catalyzed reaction causes a decrease in pH. And over here it is pretty obvious that the reaction is breaking down fats or lipids. And why is that? Because when fats or lipids are broken down, the products are fatty acids and glycerol. And fatty acids itself causes a decrease in pH due to its acidic nature. And since the question refers to the highest yield of product, the highest yield of product is when there is more of fatty acids after the breakdown of lipids in a given amount of time, leading to steeper decrease in pH, which is only shown by non-immobilized 37 degrees Celsius. Steeper the decrease in pH, that means more amount of fatty acids formed per unit time. More fatty acids formed in a given amount of time means that it is where there is the highest yield of product. Higher the yield, more fatty acids will be formed. More fatty acids formed, steeper the decrease in pH, because there will be a greater decrease in pH when there are more fatty acids, because the product, fatty acids, causes a decrease in pH. And the key over here shows that the graph where there is the steepest decrease in pH is the non-immobilized 37 degrees Celsius. Therefore, the graph that gives the highest yield of product is answer C, non-immobilized 37 degrees Celsius. Question 16. An indicator mixed with agar forms a pink color. The pink colored agar becomes colorless when put in acid. Blocks of pink colored agar are cut to different sizes and put in acid. All other variables are kept constant. Which block becomes colorless most quickly? The block that changes color the fastest would be the block with the highest surface area to volume ratio. And I have calculated towards the sides the surface area to volume ratio. For A it is 4:5, for B it is 1:1, for C it is 2:3, and for D it is 1:2. And how do you calculate the surface area to volume ratio? Well, to find the surface area, you have to know the formula. And I'm pretty sure you know the formula in order to find the surface area. The formula to find surface area is 2 times length into breadth plus 2 times breadth into height plus 2 times length into height. And the formula to find volume is length into breadth into height. Thus, carrying out these calculations would give you these ratios. And the highest ratio, or the highest surface area to volume ratio, is in answer A. Therefore, answer A will change color or become colorless most quickly compared to all the other blocks. Again, remember that the block that changes color the fastest would be the one with the highest surface area to volume ratio. Question 17. Three identical plant cells were put into one of three different concentrations of sugar solution, 10%, 5% and 2.5%. The cells were left for 50 minutes and then observed using a light microscope. Which statement is not correct? Answer A. Cell X has the same water potential as the sugar solution it was put into. Yes, that is a correct statement. Because as you can see, cell X appears to have not changed in size or shape at all. Thus, it must have been placed in a solution with the same water potential, leading to no net gain or no net loss of water, as it is of the same size or shape of a normal plant cell. Answer B. Cell Y is turgid and cell Z is plasmolyzed. Yes, that is correct. Because cell Y, the vacuole appears to be inflated. That means it has gained more water and thus it has become turgid. Turgid means there is more water inside, leading to increasing in size. And cell Z being plasmolyzed means it has lost water. The meaning of plasmolyzed is where the cell has lost lots of water content, leading to a shriveled appearance or appearing to be smaller in shape. And as you can see, the vacuole seems to have peeled away from the cell wall. That shows that the cell Z is plasmolyzed. Therefore, statement B is also correct. Statement C. Cell Y was put into 2.5% sugar solution. 2.5% sugar solution is the lowest concentration out of all the given three concentrations. And yes, cell Y appears to have gained water. That means it must have been placed in a solution with the lowest sugar concentration. Because lower the sugar concentration, higher the water potential of the solution, and that leads to more water uptake by the cell. If you know the process of osmosis is where the water moves from a region of higher water potential to a region of lower water potential down a water potential gradient. And cell Y having gained water means that initially it must have a lower water potential than the solution it was placed in. And yes, 2.5% sugar solution is reasonable over here because it is the lowest concentration out of all the given three. Lower the concentration of sugar, higher the water potential of the solution. That must have led to water being taken into the cell from the solution it was placed in, thus leading to cell Y appearing turgid. Therefore, statement C is also correct. Statement D. Cell Z had a more negative water potential than the sugar solution it was put into. More negative means that initially it had lower water potential than the outside sugar solution. However, it is the opposite. Cell Z initially had higher water potential than the sugar solution it was placed in, which is why it led to water loss. Because if you recall the process of osmosis, it flows from higher water potential to lower water potential, down a water potential gradient. Therefore, initially cell Z must have had a higher water potential than the sugar solution it was placed in, and that is why water was lost. Therefore, statement D is not correct. Statement D mentions Z having more negative water potential than the sugar solution it was put into, when rather it is the opposite. Therefore, the answer over here is statement D, because statement D is not correct at all. Question 18. How many copies of each different DNA molecule are found in a cell at the start of each of these stages of the mitotic cell cycle? Keyword of this question is at the start. DNA replication, if you remember, occurs at the S phase of interphase. And all these given stages over here, G2 of interphase, prophase and cytokinesis, occurs after the S phase of interphase. Therefore, yes, all three of them should have two copies of DNA molecule. But you may ask, why does cytokinesis have two? Shouldn't it have one? Because at cytokinesis, it splits into two. Well, the question says, found in a cell at the start. That means at the start of cytokinesis, the splitting has not yet occurred. Therefore, although at cytokinesis the DNA content splits, at the start it would have two copies. Hence the answer being D. G2 of interphase, two copies. Prophase, two copies. Cytokinesis, also two copies. Question 19. Hydra are simple animals which can reproduce asexually. The photomicrograph shows an adult hydra with a new hydra developing while attached to the side of the adult animal. Which processes have occurred in the two hydra? 1. DNA replication. 2. Growth. 3. Mitosis. Large quantities of cells are produced by growth, DNA replication, and then cell division by mitosis in asexual reproduction. Do keep in mind that all three processes occur during asexual reproduction. Thus, the answer should have all three of them, DNA replication, growth, as well as mitosis. Hence, the answer is A, 1, 2, and 3. Because large quantities of cells have to be produced by growth and DNA replication, and during asexual reproduction, cell division occurs, and cell division occurs by mitosis. Therefore, all three are involved. Hence, the answer is A. Question 20. The diagram represents a nucleotide containing thymine. Which statements about this nucleotide are correct? 1. Thymine is a pyrimidine. 2. Base pairing occurs with two hydrogen bonds. 3. The carbohydrate can be ribose or deoxyribose. Remember that only guanine and adenine are purines. The rest, that are uracil, cytosine and thymine, are pyrimidines. Therefore, yes, statement 1 is correct. Thymine is a pyrimidine. Statement 2. Base pairing occurs with two hydrogen bonds. That is also correct because T binds with A, or thymine binds with adenine using two hydrogen bonds. Therefore, statement 2 is also correct. Statement 3. The carbohydrate can be ribose or deoxyribose. The carbohydrate can only be deoxyribose. As in ribose, T is replaced with U. Remember that in ribose, the bases that are present are adenine, uracil, cytosine, and guanine. Whereas the bases present in deoxyribose are adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. Therefore, the carbohydrate over here for thymine can only be deoxyribose. It cannot be both. Hence, statement 3 is incorrect, leaving us with the only possible answer being answer B, 1 and 2 only, as all the other answers A, C, and D have statement 3 in it. Question 21. Some of the events that occur during transcription are listed. 1. Bonds break between complementary bases. 2. Bonds form between complementary bases. 3. Sugar phosphate bonds form. 4. Free nucleotides pair with complementary nucleotides. Before the mRNA molecule leaves the nucleus, which events occur twice during transcription? Both 3 and 4 occurs only once, that is during the formation of mRNA. Sugar phosphate bonds are formed when mRNA molecule is being produced, as well as free nucleotides pair with complementary nucleotides also when an mRNA molecule is being formed. If you remember the process of DNA replication, you can answer this question easily. If you don't, do go back and revisit that chapter and then come back later. Answering this question after that would be very easy. However, events 1 and 2 does occur twice during transcription. Bonds break between complementary bases. Yes, because initially the DNA molecule unwinds and unzips. When this occurs, the bonds between the complementary bases in a DNA molecule breaks. And the second stage where the bonds break between complementary bases are when the mRNA molecule has to leave and enter the ribosome. In order to leave the nucleus, it has to break its bonds between the DNA strand that helped the mRNA molecule to be formed, because mRNA molecule only forms with one of the DNA strands by initially forming hydrogen bonding. These hydrogen bonding breaks when the mRNA molecule has to leave. Therefore, yes, one does occur twice. Event 2, bonds form between complementary bases. Yes, as I mentioned, bonds that are hydrogen bonds, they do form between the mRNA molecule and one of the DNA strands when the mRNA molecule is being synthesized. And yes, they do form again when the DNA molecule has to join back together after the mRNA molecule is formed, because initially it unwinds and unzips, and then after that it has to join together to form the same DNA molecule it was initially. And thus, bonds break and form twice during the process of transcription. Hence, the answer is answer D, 1 and 2 only. Question 22. The table shows the DNA triplet codes for some amino acids. The base sequence on the DNA template strand coding for part of a polypeptide is shown. As you can see over here, the base sequence of the DNA template strand is shown, starting from CCA and ending with GCA. Two mutations occur in this sequence during DNA replication. Which mutated DNA would result in a polypeptide with one different amino acid? As you can also see, I have matched the DNA triplet codes with the corresponding amino acid, starting with glycine, followed by lysine, then cysteine, then arginine, followed by asparagine, and lastly arginine again. If two mutations occur, resulting in one different amino acid in this polypeptide, what sequence would it be? Well, let's go through the sequences A, B, C, and D. Sequence A. If you perform the matching of these DNA codons with the amino acid, you would get a stop codon being formed after the first amino acid, that is at ATC, because ATC is a stop codon. Hence, there would be no two mutations and it doesn't result in a polypeptide, because only one amino acid is formed as a result, as the process halts at the start of DNA replication. Answer B. Although the third and fourth codons have changed, the amino acids are the same. And in order to understand this question, I would recommend that you first match the given DNA codons with the corresponding amino acids in this table given above. And then you would realize which amino acids have changed and which has resulted in a polypeptide with only one different amino acid. In answer B, all the amino acids are the same. There is no amino acid which is different. Therefore, answer B is incorrect. Answer C. Only one amino acid is different, although there are two mutations. And hence, the answer C must be the correct answer. And answer D, again, no amino acids have changed. All are the same. Thus, the mutated DNA, which would result in a polypeptide with only one different amino acid, is answer C. Question 23. A gene codes for the sequence of amino acids in a single polypeptide. Hemoglobin consists of two alpha globins and two beta globins. How many genes are needed to code for a single hemoglobin molecule? Although a hemoglobin molecule consists of two alpha globins and two beta globins, only one gene is required to form alpha globin and one gene for beta globin. Because although two alpha globins and two beta globins are being involved, the same gene which can code for alpha globin can code for two alpha globins. It is only necessary to have one gene for one alpha globin, and for one beta globin also another one gene. It is not necessary to have four genes because there are four globin molecules altogether. One gene for alpha globin is enough and one for beta globin. And altogether, this would result in two genes being needed to code for a single hemoglobin molecule. This question is pretty easy. All you have to do is just understand what this question is about. At the start, they say a gene codes for the sequence of amino acids in a single polypeptide. And this single polypeptide would be alpha globin and the other one being beta globin. So one gene is enough to form alpha globin and another gene is enough to form beta globin. And although they have mentioned two alpha globins and two beta globins, this same gene can code twice to form two alpha globins and two beta globins. Thus, actually only two genes are needed. More than two or less than two are definitely incorrect. Thus, the answer is B. Only two genes are needed to code for a single hemoglobin molecule. Question 24. Which properties of water molecules are important in the upward flow of water to the xylem? 1. Water molecules are attracted to each other by hydrogen bonding. 2. Water molecules are attracted to cellulose by adhesion. 3. Water molecules have high cohesion in water columns. Actually, all three properties of water molecules are important in the upward flow of water. Property 1 is known as cohesion, where water molecules are attracted to each other. Property 2 is, of course, given adhesion. And yes, cohesion and adhesion are very important properties for the transport of water in a xylem. These two key points should definitely be kept in mind, cohesion and adhesion. They are definitely vital for the process of water flowing through the xylem. And property 3 also mentions high cohesion in water columns. Therefore, all three properties are important in the upward flow of water through the xylem. Thus, the answer is A. Question 25. The graph shows the rate of water absorption and the rate of water loss by a plant during 1 24-hour period. The plant was growing in natural conditions. What may be concluded from the graph? This question is pretty easy. As can be seen from the graph, pretty much all three can be concluded. That is, 1. The rate of water absorption and the rate of water loss peak at 16. Yes, because they do have a peak at 16. It is obvious from this given graph. Conclusion 2. The rate of water loss is greater than the rate of water absorption for 12 hours. Yes, that is also correct. Because overall, the rate of water loss lies higher than the rate of water absorption. Hence, that can also be concluded. Conclusion 3. The rate of water absorption is greater than the rate of water loss at night. Well, you have to follow the graph over here. Yes, at night, that is from 20 to 24, the rate of water absorption is indeed greater than the rate of water loss. Hence, the answer over here is answer A, 1, 2, and 3. Question 26. Which statements explain why a stem is cut underwater and connected to a potometer underwater? 1. To prevent plasmolysis of xylem vessel elements. 2. To prevent the collapse of xylem vessel elements. 3. To prevent air entering xylem vessel elements. Over here, you must definitely keep this point in mind. It is cut underwater in order to prevent it coming in contact with air, and thus it should be only statement 3. To prevent air entering xylem vessel elements. Statements 1 and 2 are definitely not statements that explain why it is cut underwater. Hence, the answer is D, 3 only. Question 27. Sucrose moves into an actively dividing shoot tip from a phloem sieve tube element. Which changes to the water potential and the volume of liquid in the phloem sieve tube element are correct? In this question, the sucrose is entering a actively dividing shoot tip from a phloem sieve tube element. In other words, the sucrose is leaving the phloem sieve tube element as it enters a shoot. Hence, the water potential increases. Why is that? Because water potential is higher when there is less solute or less sucrose in the sieve tube element. Water potential is governed by two factors, solute concentration and the pressure potential. Over here, pressure has nothing to do with this process and it is only concerned with the solute concentration. Lower the solute, higher the water potential. Thus, if sucrose, that is solute, leaves the phloem sieve tube element, the water potential increases. That means it becomes less negative. Less negative means water potential increasing. More negative means water potential decreasing. In order to make this easier, just remember the number scale, where 0 is the number of the highest water potential, because pure water has a water potential of 0, and that is the highest water potential. There cannot be a water potential greater than 0, and hence the less negative you go, the higher the water potential it becomes, because as it becomes less and less negative, it reaches 0, if you picture the number scale in your head. Again, less negative means higher water potential, and yes, it does lead to a higher water potential as the sucrose leaves the phloem sieve tube element. Hence, the answer is either A or B. And when the water potential increases inside the phloem sieve tube element, the volume decreases. And in such questions, do keep in mind, if water potential decreases, the volume increases, and vice versa. Since the water potential increases over here, the volume decreases. They have an opposite correlation. Water potential increasing leads to volume decreasing. Water potential decreasing leads to volume increasing. And since this question talks about the water potential increasing in the phloem sieve tube element, the volume of liquid decreases. Thus, the answer is A. Question 28. Sucrose is loaded into phloem sieve tubes from companion cells. What is the correct order of statements that explains this mechanism? 1. Hydrogen ions diffuse into companion cells through co-transporter proteins. 2. Hydrogen ions are pumped out of companion cells by active transport. 3. Sucrose diffuses into phloem sieve tubes through plasmodesmata. 4. Sucrose is co-transported along with hydrogen ions. The process of loading sucrose starts with hydrogen ions being pumped out of the companion cells using active transport. That is the first process in the loading of sucrose, which is only shown by C, because only C starts with statement 2. Hydrogen ions are pumped out of companion cells by active transport. Hence, the answer over here is answer C. Nonetheless, let's go through the process. It starts with hydrogen ions being pumped out of the companion cells using active transport. Then the hydrogen ions diffuse back into the companion cells to co-transporter proteins, bringing sucrose along with it. Therefore, after statement 2, it is statement 1. Hydrogen ions diffuse into companion cells through co-transporter proteins, then followed by sucrose is co-transported along with hydrogen ions. Because yes, when the hydrogen ions are diffusing back into the companion cells through co-transporter proteins, they bring sucrose along with it at the same time. And lastly, sucrose diffuses into the phloem sieve tubes through the plasmodesmata. Therefore, the correct answer over here is C. Question 29. Which components are found in arteries? Remember that arteries consist of all the components shown, because the inner layer is lined by smooth tissue called the endothelium. Collagen is present in the arterial walls, and arteries do have elastic tissue and less of smooth muscle. Therefore, all three are actually present in arteries. Therefore, do study these key points by solving such questions. Arteries, they have collagen, endothelium, and smooth muscle. Where is endothelium present? It is present in the inner layer. Collagen is present in arterial walls, and arteries do have elastic tissue as well as smooth muscle, but less of smooth muscle. Hence, the answer is B over here. Question 30. Which diagram correctly shows the direction of flow of blood through the heart? I have marked over here R and L, R meaning right side of the heart and L meaning left side of the heart. And blood always enters into the atriums of the heart, no matter what. It always enters into the atriums. The only answer that shows blood entering the atrium is answer B. Blood enters, shown by the direction of the arrowhead, into the right as well as left atrium of the heart. Therefore, only answer B is the correct choice. It enters the right and left atrium, then flows into the right and left ventricle, then lastly pumping out of the heart into either the aorta or the pulmonary artery. Hence again, the answer is B. Question 31. Which row correctly identifies the pulmonary artery? The columns given are thickness of blood vessel wall, oxygen content of blood inside vessel, as well as blood pressure. All arteries have oxygenated blood except the pulmonary artery. The pulmonary artery is an exception. It doesn't have oxygenated blood, it has deoxygenated blood instead. Thus, the answer being either A or D. And arteries, they have thick walls to maintain the pressure. So it must be definitely A, because only A has the thickest wall as well as greater pressure, because blood pressure in arteries are high, and in order to maintain the high blood pressure, the thickness of blood vessel is also greater. Hence the answer over here is A. Question 32. What is found in all blood vessels, lymph and tissue fluid? 1. Carbon dioxide, 2. Glucose, 3. White blood cells, 4. Antibodies. This is a pretty common question. All blood vessels definitely have white blood cells, antibodies, carbon dioxide and glucose. Do keep in mind these certain components. The only components that would not be found in all of them are red blood cells as well as large protein molecules. However, over here, carbon dioxide, glucose, white blood cells and antibodies are found in blood vessels, lymph and tissue fluid. Hence the answer over here is A, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Since they are not large protein molecules and they are able to pass through the pores of blood vessels and reach the lymph or the tissue fluid. Question 33. At high altitudes, the oxygen content of the air may be a third of that at sea level. As a person slowly climbs a mountain, their body gradually adjusts to the high altitude. What is increased during this period of adjustment? In order to compensate for the differences in oxygen partial pressure rising up the mountain, that is, as the person rises or climbs the mountain, the oxygen content decreases with increasing altitude. Higher up the mountain you go, the lower is the oxygen partial pressure. And in order to compensate for this difference, the body adjusts to the surrounding by increasing the number of red blood cells. Thus, the answer over here is answer C. The number of red blood cells per millimeter cube of blood is increased during this period of adjustment, not the other answers. The only answer that can be possible over here is regarding the number of red blood cells. And what happens when you go higher up the mountain? Higher up the mountain leads to lower oxygen partial pressures. Lower the oxygen partial pressure, the body compensates for this by providing more red blood cells in order to transport more oxygen per unit time. Thus, what is increased is the number of red blood cells. Question 34. Which row correctly shows features present in terminal bronchioles? The only structures that have cartilage are the trachea and the bronchus. Therefore, bronchioles or the terminal bronchioles do not have cartilage, leaving us with the answer being either C or D. And bronchioles will have smooth muscle as well as cilia. Hence, the answer over here is C. Question 35. The photomicrograph shows a section through lung tissue. Which structures are present in this photomicrograph? I have labeled which one is which. So, as you can see, in this photomicrograph, an artery is visible, a vein is visible, as well as a bronchus. Arteries over here have thicker walls than veins, as you can see, and the bronchus has an outer layer supported by cartilage, and the inner lining is a folded ciliated epithelium. Why not trachea? Because trachea have cartilage in the form of C-shaped rings. However, over here you can see blocks of cartilage here and there. It's not in the form of a C-shaped ring. Thus, trachea is not found. The only structures that are present in this photomicrograph are artery, vein and bronchus. And I would recommend that you go through your textbook in order to find such photomicrographs and do learn the structures that are present in a photomicrograph. And also by solving such past papers, do keep in mind how certain structures look like. In this photomicrograph, no trachea can be seen. Thus, the answer is A. Question 36. The symptoms of two diseases are listed. Disease 1, consisting of coughing up blood, pain when breathing, loss of weight, and disease 2, consisting of shortness of breath, difficulty breathing out, and fatigue. Coughing up of blood occurs due to lung cancer. Therefore, disease 1 must definitely be lung cancer, hence leaving us with the answer being either C or D. And disease 2, shortness of breath and fatigue are linked to emphysema. Therefore, disease 2 must be emphysema. In chronic bronchitis, it is the coughing up of mucus. And since disease 2 doesn't talk about coughing up of mucus, answer C is incorrect, leaving us with the only possible answer being D. Disease 1 being lung cancer. Why? Due to coughing up of blood. And disease 2 being emphysema due to shortness of breath and difficulty breathing out. Question 37. Disease transmission can be reduced in different ways. Antibiotic therapy for sufferers, vaccination for non-sufferers, more living space per person. The transmission of which disease can be reduced by all of these methods? Remember that antibiotic therapy or antibiotics only work on bacteria, not viruses or any other sort. It only works on bacteria. And if you look at the answers, malaria and measles are not caused by bacteria. Therefore, antibiotic therapy does not work on people who have such diseases. And also, since the question refers to which disease can be reduced by all of these methods, answers C and D are incorrect, considering between answers A and B. Answer A, cholera is caused by a bacterium which is waterborne. Hence, more living space doesn't affect much. Whereas actually more living space per person, vaccination for non-sufferers and antibiotic therapy for sufferers helps the most for reducing the transmission of TB. Do keep in mind this point. Hence the answer over here is B, TB. Question 38. What do pathogens of HIV/AIDS, malaria and TB have in common? The columns given are cell surface membrane, genes, as well as ribosomes. HIV/AIDS and malaria are caused by viruses which are regarded as non-cellular as they have no cell organelles as of eukaryotic cells or prokaryotic cells. Thus, viruses do not have ribosomes and cell surface membrane. And since the question refers to common in all three of the pathogens, there should be a cross under cell surface membrane and ribosomes, leaving us with the only possible answer being answer D. And yes, viruses do have genes because viruses only consist of a genetic material which is either DNA or RNA made up of genes and a protein coat. Therefore, what is common in all of them would be only genes. Hence, the answer is D. Question 39. The diagram shows the immune response following infection by a virus. Which row identifies the cells labeled E, F, G, and H? If you have gone through the chapter concerned with immune response, answering this question is very easy. You have to definitely keep in mind that only plasma cells can produce or secrete antibodies. And towards the end, they have shown secretion of antibodies by cell H. So cell H can only be plasma cell. Therefore, leaving us with the answer being either A or B. Under H, it should be plasma cell. And what is cell E? Cell E doesn't seem to be producing any antibodies. Therefore, it must be memory cells. Because cell F is a T helper cell, because only T helper cells produce plasma cells that secrete antibody. Therefore, F is a T helper cell which would become activated, dividing into plasma cells and memory cells. E would therefore be a memory cell and H would be a plasma cell as it secretes antibodies. And G is a T killer cell. It is not a macrophage because macrophages engulf the infected cell, whereas T killer cell just binds to the host cell and secretes cytokines. Therefore, G must be a T killer cell, leaving us with the answer being A, because we only have to consider between answers A and B, as H is a plasma cell and G is not a macrophage but a T killer cell, as it doesn't show any engulfing of the infected cell. Hence, the answer over here is A again. E is a B memory cell, F is a T helper cell, G is a T killer cell, H is a plasma cell. Question 40. Monoclonal antibodies are used to test for the presence of hormone HCG in the urine of a human female during early pregnancy. Which statements describe how the monoclonal antibodies used in this test are produced? Statement 1. HCG is injected into a mouse and plasma cells in the mouse produce antibodies specific to HCG. Statement 2. Antibodies are extracted from the mouse and then fused with cancer cells to produce hybridoma cells. Statement 3. Single hybridoma cells are cultured and they divide by mitosis to produce a clone of hybridoma cells. Statement 2 is incorrect because only plasma cells are fused with cancer cells. Antibodies, they are not fused with cancer cells in the process of formation of monoclonal antibodies. Monoclonal antibodies are formed when plasma cells fuse with cancer cells that secrete a hybridoma cell that are able to produce antibodies and keep on dividing. Thus, statement 2 is incorrect as it talks about antibodies being fused with cancer cells when it is not antibodies that are fused but plasma cells. Only plasma cells are fused with cancer cells. Do keep in mind this point. Therefore, answers having statement 2 in it are incorrect, leaving us with the answer being only C, 1 and 3 only. Yes, statement 1 is correct because HCG, that is the hormone, is injected into the mouse and plasma cells in this mouse produce antibodies specific to HCG, which is the aim of this purpose. We have to produce plasma cells specific to HCG that can be fused with cancer cells to produce a hybridoma cell. Therefore, statement 1 is correct. Single hybridoma cells are cultured and they divide by mitosis to produce a clone of hybridoma cells. That is also correct because we have to get multiple hybridoma cells, not just one. So these hybridoma cells have to be cultured and then divided to produce a clone so that they can be used in whatever test they are being used in. Therefore, statements 1 and 3 are important in how the monoclonal antibodies are produced. Therefore, the correct answer over here is C, 1 and 3 only. And that is the end of this paper. Hope you found this video useful. If you did, don't forget to leave a like, as well as drop a comment down in the comment section below, letting me know from which country you're watching this video right now. Thank you for watching and stay tuned for more.